Greetings. I'm your brother, Brother Minister Wasim Muhammad. Welcome to the Wasim Muhammad Show. And we have a very exciting show for you today, as I'm so grateful and thankful to broadcast to you. And I want to first start by saying I've always got to thank our wonderful mayor of the city of Camden, Mayor Dana L. Redd, for the wonderful job she's doing and the opportunities that she gives so many people from Camden to do some wonderful things from within our community and also from without our community. Starting with some of the partnership here with the local board of education, the partnership with our superintendent of this wonderful school district, Superintendent Payman Rahanaford. I would like to thank those wonderful people. And also the board, the advisory board member whom I sit with our board president, Ms. Catherine Blackshear, and vice president, Ms. Martha Wilson. And it's always a great honor to represent the city of Camden. But with me today, I have as I said earlier, I have young students in the studio watching this, I say Camden royalty. And this young man has meant so much to the city of Camden. He has done some great things that helped to put Camden on the map. It's our brother and Woodrow Wilson own, and our brother and our friend, Brother Mike Rozier. Peace.
Thank you for having me here, sir.
Yes, sir. I'm glad to have you. I'm so honored, and this is definitely an honor and a privilege and to the people of Camden to have one of their own to come back, as you always have given back to Camden. And
gave me a lot, so I always try to give back whatever I can do, anytime, wherever I'm at. I'm always mentioning about talking about Camden. Everybody knows about Camden, not just through me, through other great ball players too.
Yes, sir. And as we said earlier, some people, Camden and urban centers around the country always is known for when somebody make it, that they go outside the community and they come back and you never see them again. But you have always been visible in Camden. I know for me, it's an honor to sit here and interview you, growing up as one of Coach Turner's burners, as we say over at Camden High School. But over there in Woodrow Wilson, when I was a youngster in middle school, I don't think you realize, and you probably do realize, the effect that you had on us youngsters coming behind you with inspiring us and, with you going on to Nebraska. Tell some of the people and the younger people, I know people my age and older know who you are. Tell some of the younger people in Camden that's watching this. Tell them a little bit about Mike Rozier.
My name's Mike Rozier. I'm from East Camden, 27th Street. I was really raised, I left South Camden on 8th Street. A lot of people don't understand that. They think I'm from East Camden, but originally from South Camden, moved to East Camden. I was five. Okay. I have five brothers. Mom and dad, Beatrice, Garrison, Rozier, my brothers, Glenn, Tony, Joe, Billy. Billy passed away a couple years ago. Mm-hmm. Yes, and Guy's a baby of the family. Yes. But we had a close-knit family. We lived in Centerville, over in the projects, but they tore them down.
Yes, sir.
We moved to East Camden back in 65 or 64. And I was 4 years old. I remember living on 27th Street, and I seen a white guy and a black guy on a corner with fishing poles. I never seen that in South Canada.
Yes,
South Canada was all black. And I was asking my mom, what's going on? Look, they're together. My mom explained to me, it's okay, that's the way life is. Now you switch. You came over here now.
Yes,
you understand. She gave me understanding now. But I was raised in East Canada. Played Little League football, went to Kramer School, went to Davis, then went to Woodrow Wilson. Couldn't mess up. Back then, back in the 60s, 70s, Canton wasn't like it is now.
Yes, sir.
Everybody was your parent. It wasn't just my mom and dad. It was a village.
Okay.
Back then I heard, it takes a village to raise a kid. I understand it now. I'm older now.
Yes, sir.
It does take a village to raise a kid. One-on-one. Your parents, your buddy's parents is your parents.
Yes,
you mess
sir.
Up, they could correct you. You go home and get corrected again.
Yes, sir.
Your mom and dad.
Yes,
but,
sir.
It was a great experience, great time of my life growing up in Canada. I still come back to Canada. No place like home. I've been
sir.
A lot of places.
Yes, sir.
But I always tell you, there's no place like home.
Yes, sir. Well, how important you think it is to talk to youngsters and tell them about the importance of playing? You talked about playing Little League football, and you played for the Kramer Hill football team.
I played for East Camden football team.
East Camden did have a team at the time. Yes, sir.
Rosedale Vikings.
Rosedale Vikings.
Before
yes,
then, it was called Marauders. Then the Rosedale Vikings came.
Yes, sir.
I was a young boy back in Marauders. I wasn't really playing, They put me on the team. My knee pads are way down to my ankles. They put me on the team. That's my older brothers playing organized football. I was just still playing, you know, in Washington apartments, killing me after football.
Yes, sir.
But Roosevelt Vikings came along after that, and I started learning about organized football.
So how important do you think that was to your career and to you, and to keep you out of trouble and to keep you focused? Was it useful for you?
Oh, it was very useful for me. Just going to practice every day, going to school, from school to practice, do your homework, and go to bed. My mom and dad knew exactly what time, what day, where I'm at, you know what I mean?
Yes, sir.
You know, so I'm at practice, baseball, the football. I ran track for my high school or elementary school, but when school was over, I went straight to practice.
Okay. My mom and dad knew. And you did go to East Camden Middle or McGraw?
I went to Kramer.
Kramer, correct. You're absolutely correct. Yeah.
Right up the street, I could throw a rock and hit the school.
Yes, sir.
I went to Kramer, then I went to Davis. Then I went to Wilson.
So
that was my, for all my brothers, that's what we did.
Correct.
So everybody knew my family. So since me and my brother guys are the last ones coming up, we couldn't do nothing wrong because everybody knew my parents and knew my brother. So we aligned. Brother Stacy back there, he could correct me. So I had no problem with that. I understand that now. And I think that's the problem now today with the kids today. They can't be corrected. They know if you touch them, they're going to call diapers or call the cops.
Correct.
Go get their uncle or somebody gonna have somebody gonna kill somebody be fighting.
Correct. And these are some of the things that we hope to inspire and bring back that.
I think they should bring that back.
Bring that back, that atmosphere in Camden we grew up in, you know.
No doubt. I think you definitely should do that. The kids today need help.
Yes, sir.
Not just the kids, the grown ups need help too.
Yes, sir.
Because you got grown ups dealing with little kids and the grown ups are kids, little kids too.
Correct.
You know, so I mean they need all the help they can.
Okay, so now we had that's a lot for a great conversation. We're going to get into a lot of those striking things that, you know, I want people to be able to hear from Mike Rozier because we know your public life. But coming up in Camden as well, too, there's so much great talent and so many great thinkers and people who motivators and so many great engineers and, you know, things like that from Camden. I think people need to hear more from us and what we have to say, and you are definitely one of those brothers that we need to hear about, you know, some of the things that you think that's off, as we say, offline, not atypical, what one would usually talk about or hear you talk about when they see you being interviewed on ESPN or any other affiliate station that you've known for, because it's not a secret, you know, you was in fact the Heisman Trophy winner. Back in 1983,
yes, sir.
That's wonderful. Really, you want to talk about that real quick as we go back in the history?
Yeah, I was really blessed. Like I said, it started back when I was a little kid. People looking out for me, keep me in the right path. You know what I mean? I mean, I can see myself now, 28 Mitchell playing basketball, and Holmes Lounge right around the corner.
Yes, sir.
And a couple of my buddies or a couple of guys that I didn't know real well might go around the corner and get a 40. Or beer,
yes, sir.
I couldn't do that.
Yes, sir.
They could do that. You know what I mean? Because everybody in the bar knew me, and everybody there, you know what I mean? Mr. Williams, they all knew me. So like I could sneak in there. But it was a good thing. I mean, maybe I wanted to do that. You know, hang out the boys, feel in the clique with everybody else. But I'm kind of glad I didn't. That it took a village to raise me to say, no, Mike, you cannot go in there. They didn't tell me that. I just knew for a fact. I could not go to Holmes Lounge or a liquor store and buy any kind of liquor or just to hang out.
Yes, sir.
Everybody knew my parents.
Yes, sir.
So they kept me focused to do the right thing in life. Try to do. I mean, I didn't say that I was a Boy Scout. I was not a Boy Scout.
Yes, sir.
I had my problems, you know, believe me. But I got through that part of my life a lot easier than some kids had done.
And I think it helped to anchor, you know, guys like yourself coming up in that environment. Because actually, guys like you use that to our advantage growing up in life where we had to make quick decisions and thoughtful decisions because of the environment we grew up in. And that prepared us to make better decisions once we got older with life and different things. And when you get to college and have to go to class and so many other wonderful things. Now, backing up real quick, you talked about, you know, we have McGraw and the different schools like that. Now, we went on to high school and your freshman year at Woodrow Wilson. You know, did you ever think that as your freshman year, was you aspiring one day, say, man, one day I'm going to be the Heisman Trophy winner? Did you have that aspiration?
Oh.
Did you, or just the aspiration just to play on the next level?
To be honest with you, I wanted to be a trash man. I didn't want to play football. If you look at my yearbook, I wanted to be a trash man. I didn't want to play football. I was good at football. Everybody, everybody else seen it. I mean, I knew I was okay, but some people seen it beyond that. This guy, he got a great talent. Keep on pushing him, keep him focused, stay in that path. I mean, I played basketball, played football, ran track. I did all kinds of sports. I mean, I think all the sports helped me out to ground down to just being a one great. I was very gifted. I was blessed. Sir. Believe me. I mean, as far as working out, I didn't do a lot of workouts. Mm-hmm. I wasn't a workout guy. I was just naturally had great talent and good people behind me and kept me focused and do the right thing.
You want to talk about some of the great people that helped you along the way, like some of your little league coaches, if you were mentioned to the residents here in Camden, whether they're here or now.
No,
or
I think they're all gone. Mr. Love, he lived in Pensauken. I tell my partners, Mr. Pratt. I mean, all the old school boys know Mr. Pratt. Back in the day, Mr. Pratt say move. You bring that stick out. Kevin Pratt's dad, Bud Gordon's mom and dad, they kept me alive. Mr. Colbert. I mean, just the guys I hung out with. It's a close-knit family that had certain guys that I hung out with came over my house. Besides my spy brothers, they could come over my house. My mom would cook dinner for everybody. Make sure everybody gets something to eat.
Yes,
you know what I mean? You go Rozier's house, you eating.
Yes,
you know, my mom made sure, you okay, boy? You need something to eat?
Yes, sir.
You know, that's the way it was
that
back
old
then.
Camp,
hey,
man.
That's the way it was.
Spirit. Yes, sir. That was a wonderful and great spirit.
It was great, man. I mean, great. Some great people back then. There still are great people there in Camden.
Absolutely.
I'm not saying they're not, but it's just a different lifestyle now.
Yes, sir.
Different things going on now.
Yes, sir. And that's why I say that we have to just be as loud as the media portray Camden, and those of us who know that there's some great people in Camden, and Camden's a great atmosphere, that we have to be just as loud as the media is when the media may sometimes, unfortunately, show another image, another side of Camden. But Camden is coming back now. Some great things happening.
Yeah, they try to be the negative part of Camden.
Yes,
you know what I mean? But every part, I don't care where I've been at, there's always a bad part of certain areas, California, Hollywood, wherever. But to me, today, there's no place safe no more. It's not just Camden. It's not just Philadelphia. It's in Hollywood. It's in Vegas. It's everywhere. You know what I mean, if you look for, you'll find it. So, I mean, it's just a process of dealing with the young kids, things you're doing with the young kids today, something positive to keep them in line. And we got a bunch of young guys here today for the show. That's a good thing for them guys to see somebody from Camden, not just me. Yourself, you know, I call you Lil Rook all the time, you know what I mean? But you know, back then, you're a little younger than I am.
Yes,
but, you
know,
that's the way it was though. I mean, you're behind brothers, you know, you're gonna be Lil Rozier. You know, that's what those states call Lil Rozier.
Yes,
but that's,
sir.
I take it with work. I mean, look, you know how I am, so that's a good thing.
We talked about our brother, Stacey Muhammad. Let's talk about brother Stacey Muhammad. He's a wonderful story. He's gonna be a guest on this show, and I think he has a wonderful story to tell.
Oh, Stacey's a great athlete too now.
Because people don't know, there's a lot of great people from Camden, and some of them are just humble, and some of us excelled much more than others. And we're grateful for that, and we grew up in an environment, we were so proud. You know, in the 80s, when so many great people from Camden were doing some wonderful things. And we're going to come back and we're going to talk a lot to that and talk more to some of them things about great people in Camden. And we're just going to take a quick break and we're going to come back to talking about some wonderful things. I have with me one of the royalties of Camden, Brother Mike Rozier, as I call him. And we have to uplift many of ours who went away and came back and did some great things for our city. And I say that, and I say that with humility, but I want the young people to know that there's royalty in and amongst them around it. It's because it is royalty in Mike, there can be royalty into you as well, too. So we're going to take a quick break. We're going to come back, have this more of a conversation with our brother and friend, Mike Rozier.
This is not a race. On the road to financial independence, the winners are the ones who stay the course. Learn more about securing your financial future and choose to save. It will pay off in the long run.
And we are back, and I have with me here in the studio of the Wasim Muhammad Show, our brother and friend, the Camden's own Mike Rozier. And as we were saying before we took the little break, and I'm pretty sure you know, those young people who heard of you and they got an opportunity to see some of the pictures that was shown during the break of some of the great football that you did. And we're marching our way up into Woodrow Wilson. And you went to Woodrow Wilson High School for what years was that? From 70? But you were the class of 1980, that was, correct? 79.
79.
Correct, yes. Yeah. The infamous year that the turkey game is, which is the big thing here in Camden, the game between Camden High and Woodrow Wilson.
It always been like that. I mean, before me and you was born, guys, you know, that's a big thing in Camden.
Correct. Yeah,
turkey game.
Wilson,
yes, it is.
But in 1979, your senior year, and as I was a youngster, remember being at that game, and you had just broke for maybe 40 or 50 yard run. I know, you know, we was rooting for Camden High, you know, from Parkside.
And right,
you,
right.
You had
right.
did your thing, and you got down within, I believe it was the 8 or 9 yard line.
I think around the 10th yard line. I was about to score. We got a little interrupted by the Wills of Soul and the Ghetto Riders.
Yes, sir.
I guess they knew we was going in to score.
Yes, sir. And I guess they went to Camden High School.
Yeah, huh? Most of them got to go to Camden High School. But it was a nice experience. I mean, it went nationwide on a big shootout. People still talk about that to this day.
Correct.
Other places, you know, they said, Mike, was it that game up shootout? Yeah, that's my last game.
Yeah, last game,
and,
yes, sir.
It went nationwide that year.
Yeah, because that was a wonderful year because you was a standout athlete, and I believe Camden High School basketball too, with Billy Coberson at the helm, had just won back-to-back, or was a great win, back-to-back state championship, Group 4 state championship finals with 1978 squad that he played with my brother Rook. And as they know, you know, it's not a secret that anybody your age group in Camden know me as Lil Rook growing
as
up in
I
Camden.
As I always call you Lil Rook, man, you Lil Rook.
But, yes, sir.
Speaking of basketball, I mean, y'all had a great, but y'all was a great basketball team. And a great football team, man. I used to come over there and watch y'all play basketball. I used to love to watch y'all games. I played a little bit of basketball in high school, but we used to watch Ken.
Yeah. Well, I think people, even though Wilson stood out a little more and yourself playing football there, that Woodrow Wilson High School has some wonderful and great basketball teams, during that era too as well. And they won the Fruit Championship, Group 3 Championships, and kind of got overshadowed by Camden High School just a little bit, but it was some wonderful time, especially during the 80s of my time with guys.
Yeah, you're right. I think you're definitely correct.
Some great things. But that was a great year for Camden, 79. Then you went on to, as they say, the cornfields of Nebraska. How was that experience growing up in Camden in the urban area and then ended up in Nebraska?
Yeah, so. Some people always ask me how did I get there, but that year my teachers went on strike that year.
Correct.
My mom's a PTA president of Woodrow Wilson, so she crossed the picket line. Mm-hmm. So my history teacher got me for 1 point, so I couldn't go straight out of high school to any college. At that time, everybody was recruiting me, wanted me to go here, go there. But once they found out that I could not go straight out of high school, mm-hmm. everybody backed up off me, except Coach Osborne, University of Nebraska.
Okay.
By accident, I went to Nebraska. Billy Griggs mm-hmm. played for Penn Salkin, mm-hmm. played for Miami Dolphins, tight end. We were playing against those guys at that time. And they saw me play against them. Mm-hmm. They said, who's that guy? And they told me, and they came over and got me. I couldn't go straight out of high school to university. I had to go to junior college. I went to Colville, Kansas.
Yes, sir. Year. Correct.
Greyhound bus, day and a half. Duffel bag full of clothes.
Which town was that in? That was in
Colville, Kansas.
Colville, Kansas.
The biggest things down there is the Dalton brothers, the Outlaws.
Yes.
They robbed their own bank and got killed. That's the biggest thing down there.
Yes,
and Godfather Pizza came out that year.
Oh, okay.
So that's the biggest thing down there. You're talking about shock, cultural shock, man. Whew. Mm-hmm. I cried for a day and a half all the way down there. Ground bus, couldn't fly, couldn't afford to fly. Mm-hmm. But it was a learning experience.
Yes, sir.
Got to know how other cultures lived and meet different people. Mm-hmm. So I really appreciate that before I went to the University of Nebraska. That I got a little taste of college and how other people live and how to deal with other people. Mm-hmm. So from there I went to University of Nebraska. And Urban Fries from Mount Holly.
Correct.
We went to Rancocas Valley. Mm-hmm. Irv was living next door to my grandmother's house in Mount Holly. My mom's from Mount Holly.
Okay.
So me and Irv decided to go to Nebraska. Mm-hmm. And he went there before me, but we caught up each other in sophomores. And after that, it's history.
Yes, you know? Well, you want to talk a little bit about the importance of academics and why you think it's necessary that the young people really pay attention. Oh, do you think that discouraged you having to go to junior college, or you think that inspired you a little more? Because I, too, had to go to junior college for several other reasons. We're not going to say those reasons.
I feel you.
It's coming out in 86, and but I ended up at New Mexico and playing major college basketball. It was a great experience. But, you know, what do you have to say to some of the young people? And actually, like you said earlier, to some of the parents that need to know and understand this, the importance of academics.
I mean, it's very, very important. I always thought, I always hear before I got to college that, you know, they take care of your tests and they take, give you good grades. Yeah. You gotta go to class, Mike. That's a bunch of bull. I mean, when I went to Nebraska, man, look, I had to go to summer school.
Yes, sir.
I had to go to class. Mm-hmm. It's great to get your education. I mean, you could, with your diploma and say, for instance, just me and you. You got your diploma, and I just got my name. But if a job come up, you get that high paid job because you got a diploma. Mm-hmm. You definitely need a diploma in this world.
Yeah.
I mean, other than that, if you know somebody, you get a job quicker, but you're not going to move up fast. You're not going to get the high pay scale without that diploma. So it's very important to go to school. I mean, there's nothing wrong going to school. Stay focused, do the right thing, keeps you out of trouble. And you learn stuff.
Yes, sir.
I mean, you can learn stuff. I mean, I learned some street stuff, but there's more stuff to learn out there in the world to keep you on the right path for the rest of your life.
Yes,
because the street stuff, you're just going to end up in jail or dead one sooner or later.
That's right. Yes, sir. Well, we definitely appreciate that, and I'm pretty sure the community would appreciate that, and that would inspire some of the young people, you know, that what you said. But getting back to a little bit about football, you were saying, so now you're at Nebraska. And you know, your first year there, you know, I know it's a little different.
Yeah, my first year of sophomore, it's completely different.
Completely different. And it's different coming up in Woodrow Wilson, even in junior college where you may have shined, it was the man. Mm. And when you playing major college football, everybody was the man and shining wherever they were at. So how did you adjust to that? How was that adjustment?
Well, my thing was, I was very blessed. Every time, whatever I do in life, I always think that, of myself, take control, whatever situation I'm in, whatever comes up. When I walk on the field, I always thought the field belongs to me. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna do it on that field, whatever I wanna do on the field. Nobody's gonna interfere with my progress. I'm gonna do Mike. So every time I touch on the field, I just had confidence in my ability to do anything I wanted to do. I mean, I was blessed. It wasn't just me. It was God gave me that ability to do the things
I accomplished.
Believe me, I didn't do a lot of workouts. A lot of guys work out and be working all season. I never did all that. I mean, I enjoy playing football. It was very easy for me to do. It was easy for me to turn it on, turn it off. I mean,
yes, sir.
It was great. I mean, it opened a lot of doors. From till this day, when I won the Heisman, I call it a little black man because he's so dark and he's not brown. But
yes, sir.
I mean, there's a lot of guys, me and Urban Fryer could walk around together. And people recognize me first. I only played 9 years in the NFL. Urban played 18 years.
Mm-hmm.
But they recognize me first because every year I'm on the TV with the Heisman.
Correct.
I won the Heisman back in 83. But to me, I think Urban should get more props than I did. I mean, play NFL for 18 years.
Yeah, that's a major accomplishment.
You know what I mean? That's a big accomplishment.
Yes,
to me, somebody had done that kind of job, that's a big time to me. But some people don't even recognize them. They recognize me because I'm on TV every just about every year you're going to mention my name as far as the Heisman, if I'm not here or not, whatever.
Yes, sir.
I tease my son a lot now. He's getting a little older and he understands who dad really is.
Yes,
back
sir.
Then, you see kids come, he wants to jump in the picture.
Yes,
dad, my dad. But now he's understanding who his father was at that time playing ball, you know, black history. So, I mean,
yes,
I tease my boys about being black history. I mean, it's a good feeling to be black history for as me. Being
right.
black and being become
part
history.
Of history.
You know
that's
what I mean?
Right.
That's a
that
good thing
black.
To me.
That's
and
right.
You see my mom and dad and still living and still being proud of me doing the things I'm accomplished now. That's another big plus for me.
Yes, sir. We definitely appreciate that. And that's a great stand. And, you know, Heisman Trophy, you know, how did you feel at the time when you won that award? And I know everything seemed like it was everything was going right. And how did that make you feel? You
know? Well, to be honest, it felt great. We were sitting down in the first row. It was like four of us. Who was it? Me, Bo Jackson, Doug Flutie, and Steve Young at the time I won it. It felt good, but the main thing for me, being a mommy's boy, mm-hmm. until this day, I'm 54, I'm still a mommy's boy.
Yes,
and
sir.
I ain't scared to say it. I love my daddy to death,
yes,
but I always
sir.
Feel that women need a little more comfort, more protection.
For the role and job
yes,
that they do.
Right.
I understand.
Exactly.
Yes, sir.
To see my mom and dad smiling and see a kid come from Camden to accomplish winning this Heisman Trophy from Camden, New Jersey, to Coffeyville, to Nebraska, up to New York, and to win the biggest award in college history, I loved it. To see the smile on their face. I'm still getting awards, you know, Hall of Fame or whatever, and they're still around. That's another thing I really appreciate that some kids don't have today. Mm-hmm. They have two parents. I have always had two parents.
Yes, sir.
My parents are still alive. I see some of my boys, their parents are gone. Mm-hmm. And they always say, Mike, you're lucky. I know I'm lucky. Mm-hmm. I know a doubt. I know I'm lucky. Mom and dad's in the 80s. They're still doing very well. And I'm still mommy boy and still take care of them.
Yes, sir.
So I got nothing bad to say about that. People tease you about being a mommy's boy or whatever. Hey.
Well, how important do you think that played on your athletic career of having those both of those parents in your home and you know, grounding you? Of course, I heard you mention God, you know, that grounded there. Because sometimes people don't like to mention education with God, and that's great.
Oh.
That's because that is an education.
Hey, but God don't know a thing. So just, but the way I was raised, I'm Baptist. My mom stayed in church. You know, I'm saved. A lot of people won't believe that, but I am saved. I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yes, sir.
I know it wasn't for me. Everybody have something to lean on. That was me. My mom was raised us in church. Went to church on Broadway, mm-hmm. Broadway Bible Tabernacle. Mm-hmm. Now it's in East Camden. Mm-hmm. My brother, my cousin, Ronnie Shields, the preacher there now.
Dead. Okay. Yes.
But I was raised in that church since I was a little kid. All of us. Arch Steele, the Steele family. They was on one side of the pew. I was on the other side of the pew.
So yes, sir.
We all went to the same church together. And we all supported each other. So it makes a difference to have two parents and just have one.
Mm-hmm.
I know it do. I even talked to some of my boys that have just one parent. You know what I mean? And they may say, oh, Mike, I wish I had my dad around or mm-hmm. their mother around or who are their mothers or whatever. But it goes a lot further to have both parents around. But unfortunately, sometimes it don't work out that way. Just keep on working hard.
Yes, and I think that's a great conversation. I think we're gonna use that as an abbreviated moment. We're gonna talk a little more about
okay.
that because I
no
think
problem.
You know that's something that's important that you know is a discussion you know that we need to have as black men in urban America and specifically here in the city of Camden about the role of family. And now you're a father and
you
know, raising children here in Camden.
It's
as
not
you talked
easy.
About your son.
It's not easy. No, it's not
and
easy.
We want to talk about that, which you can give to the parents here in the city school district here in Camden and some of the things that they can get from by being inspired by your story, some of the things they can talk that you can talk about that can help them along the way, because this is about education and the live art of conversation. So as we come back, we're going to, as we sit here talking to our brother and our friend, Brother Mike Rozier, you heard him say that, you know, the right education starts with God. And he mentioned that. And then he started down with his wonderful parents and his mother and his father and work his way down to his teachers. And all this, to me, come under education and what we need to talk about to educate ourselves and educate our community. So we're going to come back. We're going to talk a little more about that with our brother and friend, Mike Rozier.
What are you doing, dear?
My finances. Every week I divide my allowance, some to spend, some to charity. But the first thing I do is set aside 10% to save for my future.
That's awfully grown up. Did you learn that in school?
No, Dad taught me. He said if you want something tomorrow, you have to save today. Dad's saving for retirement. I'm saving for a new bike.
Choose to save. To learn how to get started, get your free Power to Choose brochure.
He's a smart man, your father.
Greetings, we are back. We're back here talking with Mike Rozier, Camden's own, former Heisman Trophy winner and Hall of Famer, as well as College Football Hall of Fame, and played some wonderful career, had a wonderful professional career in the NFL and the USFL, Football League. And but before we went on, you was talking about the importance of family and how that rooted you not only on the court but off the court, off the floor as well, off the field. Pardon me as well. Just talk about that a little more. The importance of mother, father, family, and community, neighborhood.
It's very important. You know, it grounds you. It makes to me. It makes you the person that you are today. To me, like I said, back in my days, my whole neighborhood could correct me if I'm out of line. Mr. Rockabaldo is a great family across the street from Italian family. They straightened me out. Everybody on my block knew of the Roziers, and we knew of them. Mm. And everybody knew their kids and their mothers. How you doing, Mr. Rockabaldo? How you doing, Miss Gordon? Or every morning, every time you see somebody, you spoke to them, you did the right thing. That's where we were brought up. Mm-hmm. Today, the kids don't even say hello to you.
Yes,
don't
sir.
Hold the door for somebody, or older person that you don't know. Hold the door for them. Mm-hmm. That's where I was raised. Mm-hmm. I still do it today.
And
I still have my son now as 12. Somebody comes to the door, you don't got to know that person hold that door. You hold that door for that young lady.
That's right.
Or that older gentleman, all right? Because one day, you're going to be an older person, and you hope somebody do that for your parents. Because daddy ain't going to stay young forever. Mm-hmm. And your mother, too. So, but, you know, I try to put that in him. I'm more like the disciplined guy with my son that you know of. Mm-hmm. My wife's more like the book type. My wife's a lot smarter than I am.
Yes,
I ain't saying I'm dummy now, but. I got to give it to you. She's a very intelligent woman.
Well, I think that's great that you can have the confidence, self-confidence as a man to say that and still be who you are. I think sometimes men don't like to make that statement. I mean,
it's great. No, my mom, I'm only telling the truth. You know, I tell you like it is. Well, as far as I see it, as far as I'm dealing with, you know, some people, like you said, some guys won't even say that. They think you're supposed to be above the woman or whatever. But that's all I know.
Yes,
everything's working out for you right now and it's working smoothly. Keep like that. But you know, to help each other out, you got to do the right thing.
And your wife, what does she do? Is now
she's a public defender. She runs the public defender's office in Mays Landing, down towards Atlanta City.
Yes, sir.
So she graduated from Hampton. Matter of fact, her school was playing Kentucky yesterday.
Last night,
she was so happy.
Sir.
Like, we're in the championship. We're in Nebraska.
Yeah.
Don't worry, you're gonna leave. So
exactly.
So unfortunately, they didn't leave.
Yes, sir. Do you keep in contact with a lot of people in Nebraska now? You talked about. Irvin Fryer.
I can't contact a lot of guys.
I
don't miss the game. That's one thing. I never miss my football career. I do enough stuff and be around different places that people still talks about football or whatever. So it don't bother me. I don't, to be honest, I really don't watch football. I mean, I've been doing it all my life. So
yes,
it's like, why watch something you did all your life? You want to do something else.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, I do a lot of speaking engagement.
Yeah.
I go to
we wanted to talk about that. What are some of the things that you're doing now? I think, you know, sometimes, you know, and I'm so grateful and thankful for this opportunity to highlight so many wonderful people from Camden and Camden County and our region, you know, because sometimes a lot of our people, you know, because Camden is in the Philadelphia market as far as media, sometimes we don't get the direct things from people from Camden to know what they're doing now and some of the things we're doing now. You know, we some of us know what you did, but a lot of people don't know what you're continuing to do now.
Well,
to stand out and do some of the great things that you're doing today.
Well, there's a lot of things I do. I mean, I don't try to do it for publicity or let everybody know what I'm doing. I mean, the main thing is just get out there and do it. In your heart, you know what you're doing. You're trying to make a difference.
Mm-hmm.
Just get out there and do it. I mean, you got to let everybody know. I had to press there or say your name on TV or whatever. All that's it's a bunch of hype to me.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he knows what you're doing. You know what you're doing, and your friends know what you're doing. So, I mean, I go to Ronald, like a friend said, I take my son down to Ronald McDonald's house down the street here.
Mm-hmm.
He has little action figures. We go down there, I show him how lucky you are to have the things you have now, and these kids are in here sick.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Some of them not going to be around for 3 or 4 days or a month. Some of them going to be gone.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so be happy and grateful for the things you have and the things, don't complain about what you don't have.
Mm-hmm.
You know, God gives you what you need, not what you want. So be happy about that. So I try to put that in him as he's growing up.
Yes, sir. That's great. That's great. And let's go back to a little more to your football career. And when you got out, the USFL was an emerging league. coming about. And was that a tough decision for you to make? I think people, I've always wanted to ask you that. Was that a tough decision to make, whether to go to the USFL and you or the NFL, which is a great decision to have or a position to be in?
They're both football. Both guys play on both sides, 11 each side. But USFL is paying more money.
Yes. So
I come from a big family.
Yes.
NFL has given me 3.3 for 4 years. USFL gave me 8 guaranteed. So, what choice do you make?
It's
no brain. I knew sooner or later going to be in the NFL.
Yes, sir.
And I ended up there in 85 after we folded up. USFL folded up in 86. But I left there early. I went to Houston Oilers.
Yes, sir.
So I did most of my years in Houston.
Was Earl Campbell still there, correct? Oh, yeah, just left.
I didn't take Earl's spot, but I came there. Earl went to New Orleans.
Okay.
I always say I didn't take his spot.
So you take his spot.
No, I didn't take his spot. No, I did not take his spot. Earl's a hell of a running back.
Yes,
a nice guy, but it was, as you get older, that's what they do in the NFL. The younger guy come up,
starts
sliding other older guys on. That's right. I mean, same with me. I retired in Atlanta. I did most of my years at Houston Oilers. Warren Moon was my quarterback. We started to run and shoot back then.
Yes, sir.
You know what I mean? The spread offense, everybody's trying to run now. Mm-hmm. They call it different stuff now, but I retired in Atlanta in 92. I was 32 years old. Some people could retire at 32, some can't, but it was just time for me to hang up my cleats. You know,
yes,
I wanted to do something different. And speak to kids, mm-hmm. go to a lot of hospitals, see a lot of sick kids, play a lot of charity golf outings.
Mm-hmm.
That's about it.
Yes, sir. I see you preserve your body, still in shape. And you think that, because you look at some of the athletes that came and just finished playing, some of them don't preserve their body, whether it's from, it's not just physical health, because sometimes mental health can affect your physical body. But it seems like you kept yourself mentally in shape, mentally healthy, and when that starts with the physical health. Yes, sir.
I'm kind of like, I'm not really a health freak, but I like to look good in my clothes.
Yes,
so.
Sir.
I always try to keep my weight down.
We call that Camden swag.
I see most of my boys, you know, they.
Yes, sir.
Some guys are looking like, what happened to you? What you eating, a cow? You got to take care of your body.
Yes, sir.
That's your temple. If you don't take care of that, you need your body feel good or you won't feel good.
That's right.
All right? So you want to try to live long, take care of yourself.
Yeah.
Do the right things. I mean, I was smoking one time. It's been like maybe a month now I haven't been smoking.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to kick that habit.
You know what I mean?
But I feel good.
Well, one thing that athletes or being involved in athletics can do that when you have an issue that you're trying to do something, that you can stay at it because people didn't see those long years. Like you said, you didn't work out a lot.
No.
But I'm pretty sure you kept your body in shape by playing basketball because people don't know a lot of football players play basketball in the off season to keep their body in shape, to keep their cardiovascular
system. Well, I played basketball.
System.
I rode a bike a lot. You know, I was a bike rider, so I love to ride bikes. I still ride a bike today.
Mm-hmm.
I still stretch. Before I lifting weights, I was just a natural, just God just gave me a gift, man.
As we say, hard hit back in the day, yes.
But I did stretch and I did ride my bike and play basketball.
Mm-hmm. And I know it was a wonderful thing for young guys like me when I was coming up and you were coming up in high school to see you, you know, around town in Camden. You always was a humble brother, humble spirit. You know, you always,
you know,
spoke to young people and it speaks to you today. Do you think that the 9 years instead of the 18, as you talked about, Irvin Fryer, do you think that helped to preserve some of your mental health and physical well-being? Being as though, you know, you see some of the times the NFL got the lawsuits now with the concussions and different things. Speak to that. You know, we get it directly from you.
A lot of guys ask me, how come Mike, you know, they're getting away money. I feel though there's nothing wrong with my body or my head, my concussions. I never had one because if you see my running style back when I ran the ball, I didn't let somebody tackle me. I'd rather tackle you. So I usually give you the punishment instead of you punishing me.
Yes,
I didn't go head first. I usually use my arms to get you away from my body. But, you know, they tell me now, Mike, why don't you go collect some money? I could go and say I got concussion or something wrong with me. I'm just jinxing myself.
Right now,
that's what I feel though. So I don't want to do that.
Yes, sir.
Right now, I feel great. There's nothing wrong with me. So why do that? Get a little extra money to lay down on the road. Something comes through and I got old timer like that, because of football. And no, it's because I took that money. I shouldn't have took it.
Yes,
that's what I feel. So
and I think
money's not everything anyway. I mean, growing up, six boys, we had a lot of love in the house. My parents didn't have a lot of money. Mm-hmm. We had a lot of love in the house.
Yes, sir.
And that came
stay right there, because I think that a lot of young people in Camden need to hear that and understand that, because you know, of course, as I said, you had a decision to make when you were coming out of college, whether to go to the USFL or to the NFL to play football. And that was, like I said, that was a wonderful decision, opportunity to have, to be in a position to make that decision. Uh-huh. So many of our young people today have other decisions to make, and they make money decisions based on negative things and things that tear down our community instead of lift up our community, or things that just entertain, such as football. And I heard you just say that money isn't everything. And although you made the decision because it was mathematically sound financially as you were setting yourself up, but now you didn't let money buy you, as you're saying, what I'm hearing from you now and saying that. And talk to the young people about that, how they think, because they have to sell drugs or something negative, or rob or steal just to get the money, but it's about that inner well-being, if you would like to speak to that.
Yeah, I mean, back in my day, I did some wrong things back in my day.
Believe me.
I've been shot 3 times. Thank the Lord I'm still here. Mm-hmm. I did the drug thing. But no, like you want me to talk about it, money's not everything. A lot of young kids today think they go make a hustle on the corner for 4 or 5 hours. You know, back in my days, it was a hustle. Mm-hmm. Guys make little change on the corner. I ain't saying it was right, but they could pay a phone bill or pay electric bill. Now it's like kids out there doing it now, it's like a regular job, a 9-to-5 job. That's all they doing. Mm-hmm. You can't collect no pension selling drugs.
That's right.
What you gonna do when you can't be an OG when you're 57, 70 years old? You can't be out in the corner. You can't be trying to hustle a little girl or be a pimp. You can't do that no more. So what you gonna do after you get done selling your drugs or after you get done doing your work? You get a pension. Mm-hmm. Most people who got an honest job get a pension. Mm-hmm. I know some kids that don't even know what a pension is. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes I sit down and explain to them what a pension is. Something you get from your government that you work all your life, they're gonna pay you back on when you get older. Mm-hmm. If you make it that age, though. Mm-hmm. And the way the kids are today, they're not gonna make 50 years old. Correct. I see kids, I talk to kids, I tell them, some of you are not gonna be here next year. Mm-hmm. And you're younger than I am. I might not be here next year. But believe me, you look around the room right now, you're gonna miss somebody next year. Mm-hmm. They won't be here. It happens, you know? You gotta do the right thing. But like I said, money's not everything. If you're living comfortably and you got great friends, that's enough money. That's all I need. Mm. That's all I need.
And what do you mean by great friends? Somebody that would tell you
somebody
things.
Somebody telling you what you're doing wrong. Somebody not guiding you in the wrong way. Yo, Mike, you should know you shouldn't be doing that. So let's go this way instead of going that way with Jimmy. No, Mike, let's go this way. Somebody's positive, you know what I mean? Don't be a follower, be a leader. I always tell my son all that. Mm-hmm. Be a leader. Don't follow your boys doing something stupid. Let them follow you doing something positive.
That's right. Yes, sir.
I tell them all the time.
Yes, sir. We speak to that. And that's a wonderful thing. And, you know, you mentioned some of the things about your life, and which really, you know, to me, that means nothing, that you saying that, you know, we all of us didn't walk the right path or did something that we, you know, that we, that's why we're in church, mosque, temple, synagogue.
For the ups and downs in life.
Yeah, exactly. That's a part of the community.
It is. I mean, it's not, living is not 100% great every day. No, you're going to have your ups and downs. It's not how you fall, it's how you get up. Mm-hmm. Or if you do fall. And sooner or later you will fall, believe me, because nobody stays on top. I know people got buku money, they're not even happy.
That's right.
You know what I mean? I know guys got money, they killed themselves. They're not happy.
That's right.
Money's not everything. Mm-hmm. But like you said, if you got a great backbone, like your family, your friends, people that love you and tell you what you're doing wrong, ain't scared to tell you, yo, Mike, shouldn't be doing that.
That's right.
The ones that love you, that's the ones that's gonna take care of the rest of your life.
Yes, sir.
And things will come around to you again. Believe me, it will.
There it is. You have our brother going into some wonderful things, the great community conversation that's intended, what we wanted to intend to do with this program, the Wasim Muhammad Show. And we're going to take a quick break. We're going to come back for our last segment, and we're going to have Mike to talk about whatever he want to talk about the city of Camden and some of the great things he did. We'll be right back.
At that moment, it hit me. This is why I joined the Guard. I couldn't believe it. I just saved a life. Somebody from my hometown. Be there for your community.
at NationalGuard.com.
Greetings again, and we are back, and we're winding down on this segment, and, you know, where did time go at it? When you're having such a great, as we say, the lively art of conversation, and this is what this show is intended to do, to have that lively art of conversation, to talk to some wonderful people from Camden that's doing some wonderful thing to help out our children, youth, and families here in the city of Camden. And I was just talking to the mayor this morning and in a conversation, and she was at the White House. She's there lobbying, trying to get some money to help the city of Camden. And she was saying how in the vice president wing of the White House that there's a someone that's on President Obama's cabinet who was the former mayor of Louisville, Kentucky. And he came in the studio. I mean, he came in the, not the studio, I'm stuck on studio, but he came in the office where they were at just to thank her because he heard that she was there, to thank her about some of the wonderful things that Camden helped to do in Louisville to help put their city on the map, of course, with Milt Wagner and Billy Thompson in 1986 winning the national championship for college, NCAA college basketball. You had just, from 83, a few years earlier, won the Heisman Trophy winner at Nebraska and was playing in the USFL and about to go to the NFL and do some wonderful things. It was just a great time for Camden, the city of Camden. And she was telling me how proud she was at that time to be the mayor of Camden, is that people, that y'all name was resonating and helped people all over America and really all over the world to do some wonderful things. How do you feel about that, you know?
I feel blessed just to do it, to have the opportunity to do that. Like being raised by the right people, the right neighborhood. Like I said earlier, it wasn't just my family raising me, it was my neighborhood raising me. And to be proud to come from Camden and hear about, they mentioned Camden, they mentioned my name. Mm-hmm. And like you said earlier, when I go places, I tell them from Camden, they mention other ball players or they say Camden might be bad. Then I got to check them and explain to them, Camden's not that bad. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? There's other places as worse as Camden is. Mm-hmm. But a lot of great people in Camden that you never even heard of. Mm-hmm. Or there's some people out there you did hear about. So Camden's not that bad.
Yes, sir. Yeah, and I know you helped.
There's no place like home, though. That's my home. Right. I was going to say Camden's.
Yes, I know you helped to inspire so many young people in football because, you know, because kind of after you left, Woodrow Wilson emerged as this great high school football, you know, paradigm here in the city of Camden, even though it was doing well then. But after you left, and how do you feel about the stadium being named after you? That's another honor.
That's another honor. I mean, this, yes, sir. Like I said, just talking about going back to my parents again, just to see, you know, I always tell people till this day, you know, my last name belongs to my parents. Mm-hmm. So if you get out there and mess up, you're messing up your parents. Mm-hmm. All right, you're embarrassing them. You're embarrassing yourself, yeah, but you're embarrassing your parents because your last name belongs to them. They yes, give you last name. Hold up, hold the name up. Do the right thing. But to have my name at my football stadium, it means a lot to me, but I feel that it means a lot more to my parents.
Oh, yes, and praise be to Allah. Yes, that's a wonderful thing. And the city of Camden, what do you think about some of the positive changes? And like you said, when you say you're from Camden, sometimes it hits a negative note with some people, but Camden is coming around now. And,
it's coming back. It's coming back. Slowly but surely, it's coming back. It's going to take a little time.
Yes, sir.
They got a new police force. I don't know what the old police force was about too much because I stayed out of their way.
So, yes, sir.
But I heard as far as the crime and different things are going down less than it was last year. Mm-hmm. Maybe some people don't like it, but that's we got to have to do it. That's we got to do it.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Now, talk about real quick some wonderful people that you hung around that in Camden, and as we talk about the great people that you met along the way, Irvin Fryer, you know, of course, the Milk Bill.
Me and Irv grew up together. My mom's from my heart. He's earlier than still my grandma. So I knew Irv since I was 5 years old. Bud Gordon, Mel Gordon, Kevin
yes, sir.
Pratt,
Mel.
I mean,
yes,
those
sir.
Guys yeah. I grew up with, Milt Thompson. You know, it wasn't, even though Milt was from Canada High or Irv from Rancocas, I'm from Wilson, but we all hung out, you know what I mean? We made a little park across the street from Canada High.
Yes, at the park.
Or the waterfront.
Yes,
we
sir.
We used to just go down there and hang out, no fights, everybody got along, and went home.
Yes,
you
sir.
Know what I mean? Today, you know, most of the parks are closed down. The kids can't go in there to hang out or even have socialize and talk to each other. Mm-hmm. You know, they don't know each other is who they are, because they don't do it no more.
Yes, sir.
It was a good thing for us to do it when I was growing up.
Yes, sir. There's wonderful people in Camden. You said the East Camden section. You think you grew up on 27th Street. Now,
yeah.
I think my wife was grew up on that block too as well. I think you went to church with my wife.
Yeah.
And then
I remember way back when she was down the Birches at that time.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know your wife really well.
And some wonderful people in Camden. Is there anything, Mike, that you would like to, you know, people in Camden to really know, something that you, every time you get interviewed, that you want to say, but you don't get the opportunity to say? And here it is, you have it right now. Just think about it, if, you know, some things that you want to say.
Well, not really. I mean, I do a lot of interviews. I'm usually the type of guy, say what's on my mind. I mean, if I hurt somebody's feelings or I say the wrong thing, whoops, that's shame on you. But I usually say what's on my mind or what's bothering me at the time, or what I feel that's need to be saying at the time. The kids today in Camden is different than when I was growing up. Like I said earlier, I had two parents, and my neighborhood can correct me too. There's my parents too. I think that's the problem today with any kid in Camden, East Camden, South Camden, North Camden.
Mm-hmm.
It's the parents. I wouldn't say the parents. It's simply like the parents' fault, and it's not the parents' fault. Growing up with two parents is a lot better than having one parent. Mm-hmm. I noticed that for a fact, because I grew up with two parents. Now, some of my boys grew up with one parent. So that do make a difference. But it's up to the child to learn in school. Okay, what type of school you put them in, or what type of programs in. If the kid's gonna learn any school, bad school, you might call Woodrow Wilson bad or Kenton High good. If the kid prepare himself for the schoolwork, he's gonna do good. Mm-hmm. So you have a bad teacher, but if you prepare yourself for the schoolwork and do the right thing, go home and study, do your homework, you have good grades.
Mm-hmm.
And just stay out of trouble. Do the right thing.
That's great. I think, and you know, with guys like you coming back to help to push that message that we're trying to push to our people, because it's a heavy lift. We need a lot of people to say a lot of great things. And, you know, Camden High School had a wonderful year in football this year. You know, yeah. Wilson struggled a little bit. I know they're going to turn that around with some grateful things. And
we got beat us.
Yes. You know, that's the thing, the Turkey Game. As we talked about earlier, you didn't get a chance to. What was your record against Camden High in the Turkey Game?
I don't know, but we were about to score a touchdown, and then,
the Camden High got
some guns out, you know what I mean? So, it's all good.
Yes, it's all good, and I think it's a wonderful conversation, and, you know, that era of Camden basketball, Camden football, just from being the Camden period, a lot of people don't know that in the 70s, you know, Philadelphia, Camden, and the Delaware Valley was the place to be. You know, you had Leon Huff, another Camden.
Oh, yeah.
Camdenite, who was writing great music, and Vic Karstoffen, Sr., who was writing great music from...
There's a lot of great people come out of New Jersey, period. This is not just Camden and New Jersey, period. I mean, a lot of guys, Kevin Ross, Paulsboro.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you hear Kevin Ross before Kansas City Chiefs. I know Kevin real well. So, I mean, a lot of good athletes came out of Camden, a lot of good people came out of Camden.
Yes, sir.
Camden's not everything that everybody said it is, but some good people came out of here.
Yes,
and it's coming back.
Yeah, and I think it's wonderful that people get an opportunity to hear you speak out of the box of football, and to see, you know, you're speaking about being a parent, about growing up in a family with both parents, and about, you know, the great moves that, you know, you got into a little bit of politics and different things about the move of the Camden Police Department and, you know, different schools and things like that. I think it's wonderful that people hear that conversation, because they want to put us in a box of being great athletes, and you did shine on that. But athletics inspire other things that's in you that you can carry with you in your life. And if you want to talk to that.
I get a chance to say what I want to say, because I'm an athlete. I'm not a great athlete, but I could talk some places that maybe you won't be able to talk to because I'm an athlete.
Correct.
Or because I won a Heisman.
Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of crazy, but that's the way society is, though.
Correct.
I mean, there's a lot of great athletes out there now. They got a voice. They can say anything they want to say, and nothing will happen to them.
Mm-hmm.
I feel there should be more athletes talking more about education or what's going on in the neighborhood or what's going on around the world. Mm-hmm. But some guys are scared to say they might get fired or whatever.
Do you feel the athletes today are a little different than the athletes that grew up in your time?
Oh, yeah, no doubt.
They're afraid to say something because there's so much money involved and so many
things. Yeah, I mean, it's a whole lot of money involved. But I mean, some will lead and some will follow.
Yes, sir.
So, yeah. It's part of life.
Do you think that being inspired by, you know, when we grew up in the 70s, you know, Muhammad Ali probably was the great athlete then of our time, you know, before there, as I try to tell young people, before there was a Michael Jordan or LeBron James, there was Muhammad Ali. And Muhammad Ali was not only just a great boxer and athlete, he was a great man that stood up for social change.
Yes, he did.
He took stands and
that was my man there. I mean, he refused to go to Vietnam. He was right to me growing up. The things he was talking about at that time and at that era, I think was right to do.
Yes, sir.
He's the best boxer in the world to me. That was my man. My dad loved Joe Frazier. Ali was my man. So,
yes, okay,
what did he say? But he spoke the truth. And he was a great athlete back then. And he said what he was on his mind. Mm. And he couldn't say nothing to him. So he said, like I was just saying a couple minutes ago, as far as athletes, they got the word to talk, but they're scared to say something because it might get fired or whatever. Mm-hmm. Ali was the type of guy, he didn't care. Because mm-hmm. he was the man, he was a champ. So he said he wanted to say, and yes. he did.
Especially when you got something to say.
Yes.
This is what we're trying to instill in our young people, yes. that if you're going to be loud and be intelligent with something.
Yes.
Just don't, as we say, throw cabbage at the back of the room just because you can get, just because you can.
Right.
Get an agenda and be focused. As we winding down now, Mike, and is there anything that you would like to send a shout out to somebody in Camden or somebody or just to the young people that's here?
Not just somebody, just all the Camden. Just keep to the young kids, keep on working hard. Don't never give up. If you fall, get up. It's not how you fall, it's how you get up. If you got one parent, one grandma, one dad taking care of you, do the best job you can.
Mm-hmm.
You know, don't quit, because I didn't quit, and look what happened.
Yes, sir. We appreciate that. And what do you think about I don't have, did you get the opportunity to meet our mayor yet, Mayor Dana Redd? Have you met her yet? And
no.
The superintendent, Mr. Payman Ron Hanford?
No,
yeah, they just sent me a text that they was might get here
because
they wanted to meet you, because I said some wonderful people from Camden that can really help to inspire some great things and great people in Camden, because that's a part of being an educator. You know, being a former educator, I taught in the Camden public school systems for 9 years before I started being an entrepreneur, became minister. And you know, that anchor of inspiration that we can give, you know, being from Camden, helped out a lot in me being an educator and inspire young people. And that's what we try to do, inspire young people from the inside out and not the outside, and, you know, looking to gain something. We're doing it because we love it. And I feel that from the passion of your heart, and I want others to see that. I want others to know that, and knowing you and in the city of Camden. So I thank you for taking the opportunity and coming in here and speak to the residents of Camden and let them know what you are continue to do, what you're doing and continue to do as, not as Mike Rozier, the Heisman Trophy winner and the NFL player, but as Mike Rozier, the father, the community member, you know, as you said, that you're saved and, you know, there's some wonderful things, and I thank you.
Thank you.
There it is, yes, sir. So. There it is, brothers and sisters. We have a great interview with a great person. As I can say, being a man, you can feel the vibration, the spirit of people when they talk of their sincerity. And I think it's a kind of conversation that he have, and we can have this conversation with our young people here in the city of Camden and with our adults. And maybe we can use this interview as a way to sit some of our young people down and say, see, there is, you know, great people from Camden, and they can talk about some wonderful things of our city. So I thank you, and until next time, we'll see you again. On behalf of our mayor, Mayor Dana Redd of the City of Camden, our superintendent, Mr. Payman Rahanaford, and the Advisory Board of Education, on behalf of Ms. Catherine Backshire, I thank you. Greetings. See you again next time.